Hello everyone, my name is Lamia.
Hello, my name is Sami.
And today we will be presenting about teaching psychiatry in a smart world from digital whiteboard to virtual reality.
So the idea of this presentation came from the fact that we use these different methods based on modern technology in different teaching sessions, either in Tunisia or in Qatar, in the UK, as well as in international conferences. And the feedback was overwhelmingly positive overall. So first of all, we have no conflicts of interest regarding this presentation. So we are going to talk about learning, and when we talk about learning, we mainly talk about long-term memory. And when we talk about long-term memory, it's always very important to understand that long-term memory needs working memory and needs attention. So if you don't have adequate attention, you are not able to learn or to encode anything into your long-term memory. And the problem here is that the attention span is often said to be around 10 minutes, no more than 10 minutes, even though we have various definitions according to, various definitions. We have different findings from less than 1 minute up to 50 minutes of attention span. Something very interesting is that there's possibly some shrinking of this attention span over the years. We think that younger generations might have less of an attention span than maybe older generations. Is that due to the influence of modern technology? This is possible because maybe younger generations are no longer trained to focus or to sustain focus over long periods of time. They use laptops, smartphones much more than, for example, dictionaries or books or anything that might require more sustained attention. And now, increasingly, most of our medical students, most of our trainees in psychiatry belong to millennials or Generation Y, and increasingly even to Generation Z. So these people might be very comfortable with IT, much more than older generations, and might get easily bored with classical methods of teaching. So that's why we think that these modern methods of teaching might enhance both attention and long-term memory. How? Through the use of different contents, visual, auditory, etc. So this can grab the attention and improve learning. Through emotion, so we will see that many of these methods are actually funny. So this fun part or this fun component can enhance attention and learning. And then most of them are also interactive. And through this interactivity, we believe that attention is better and learning, a long-term memory is also made better.
So we are facing more and more radical changes in teaching methods. We are living in a more and more digital world where everyone has laptops, smartphones, tablets, and young people, the generation Y, is using all these methods to access and look for information. And then there is a number of publications skyrocketed in the last years, and articles are all accessible online. And it is more and more difficult to access all this information. So most importantly today, we should not give students information, but we should teach them how to access all this information. And thus, by teaching them skills like team building, time management, and etc. So teaching, we need to teach people who are really young how to use this technology for everything. And lastly, Corona increased our use of online material presentation and communication, which make the use of digital technology even more important now than ever.
So when we are talking about modern tools, what are we actually referring to in particular? So we are talking about online whiteboards, live surveys and polls. We are going to talk about live quizzes as well, about comprehensive solutions, and about virtual reality. And we are going to go in this order, okay? So let's start with online boards. First, but it's very important as well to understand that for all of these solutions, we have two different modes in general. So we have a teacher mode and a student mode. What does this mean? This means that so there are two types of login. The presenter or the teacher will have a certain account, and students or participants will have a different type of account. And most of these tools that we are going to see are available for use on laptops, on tablets, on smartphones, basically on any device that can access internet. And they are available through or across a wide variety of operating systems. They can also be used through any kind of browser, actually. So, and for each application or for each website, we'll clearly see that there's a login for teachers and another login for students as well. So let's start with virtual whiteboard. So there are different apps here. So throughout this presentation, we are only going to talk about free applications, even though most of these free solutions also have like paid versions as well. So these virtual whiteboard solutions can be standalone. So you have, for example, the EWW app or the whiteboard.fi. So these are solutions that only consist of a virtual whiteboard, but virtual whiteboards can also be part of more comprehensive solutions, as we are going to see. Basically, the idea is that we have a big board, okay, and any participant can write, draw, or add images or anything on that board. So what are the pros and cons of these virtual whiteboards?
Yes, Sammy. So virtual whiteboards are very useful for brainstorming. If, for example, participants want to share ideas, they are also very helpful for open-ended questions where they can write their answers on the board and the teacher will have all the answers, can see all the answers. And then for collaborative teamwork, where each team will have its own whiteboard and then they can write their different ideas. However, it is less engaging than some other tools because it's less fun than quizzes or virtual reality. And at the end, it's still the closest tool to a normal whiteboard. So the fun part is you're really lacking in the virtual whiteboard.
Absolutely. Here we go to the second type of instruments that we can use or tools that we can use. So live surveys or polls. So there are different applications for that. One of the free applications is Poll Everywhere, but there are also, surveys or polls that can be built in most quiz apps, and we are going to see quiz apps later in this presentation, or also as part of more comprehensive solutions. And also we are going to talk about these solutions in general. So a quiz, it's easy. So the teacher or the presenter will just put this quiz live. So the quiz can be either prepared beforehand or even prepared during the session itself with different, of course, options, as we can see here. And then there's simply a means for the students to join, either by going to a certain website and then typing a PIN code for this particular poll, or the other possibility is to actually log in through an application or even send an SMS. Okay, and then immediately you have in real time the results that you can project, for example, the results of this poll. So what are the pros and cons of these polls?
So the pros are that they are really useful for MCQs or for getting feedback if you have no wrong or right answers that you're seeking for. Like, for example, when you are surveying opinions. However, the virtual whiteboards, they are less engaging than quizzes because the competitive part is missing. For example, like having restrained time for answers or playing in teams.
Absolutely. So let's go to more engaging and more fun, more funny tools of teaching. So live quizzes might be some of the most funny tools that we can use. And so participants or students can have fun and at the same time learn quite a lot through these live quizzes. So we have lots of apps. Kahoot, Quizzes, and Slido are applications that offer free solutions and paid solutions as well. The quizzes can also be part of more comprehensive solutions like Socrative or Google Classroom, for instance. So here, as you can see, the quiz is a bit similar sometimes to a poll or to a series of polls, but there's a competition. So there are different questions, generally MCQs. And then after each question or at the end of the quiz, you can display the right answer. You can display the answers of the different participants. And then there's a timer as well, so you can time each question. There's a scoring system. And then at the end, of course, you'll also have some sort of a rank or order who got the highest score, who got the lowest score. So what are the pros and cons of these live quizzes?
Oh, live quizzes are definitely my favorite. They are very engaging. We have a lot of fun there. And they are flexible because you can have either a teacher-based quiz, which means like the teacher will choose when to go to the next question and show the answer, or you can have a student-based one, which means that the student will choose when to go to the next question and answer. And it can be used to test the student knowledge. But, however, it has its cons. If you want to ask open-ended questions, it's not really the right tool to use because most quizzes require wrong or right answer and MCQs.
Exactly. So let's go to the solutions that we talked about. So among these solutions, there's Socrative, Google Classroom, among other comprehensive solutions. So there are other paid comprehensive solutions that we did not include here because we wanted to focus on free solutions. Okay. So as you can see here, for example, and this is a Socrative screenshot. So you can have different tools at the same time. So you can actually launch a quiz. So you prepare this quiz before the presentation, and then here you can launch the quiz very easily. You can just ask a true-false question, like some sort of a very quick survey or a multiple choice, like also a very quick poll or survey, or a short answer, meaning an open-ended question as well. So you can also enhance the fun part through a space race where you see how many questions can participants answer in a certain period of time, for example, over 2 minutes, 5 minutes. So there's some sort of a race between participants. At the end of the session, you can also have an exit ticket, like small quiz at the end of the session. So these solutions are really versatile and can offer many of the solutions that you have talked about earlier. But what about their pros and cons, Lamia?
So as you said, these tools is very comprehensive because you have one piece of software for multiple tools, which make it really versatile. But the problem is that it's not often as good as a single purpose apps for a given task, because a single purpose app will offer more options for that multiple tasks.
Yes. So now we go to virtual reality, and we are increasingly talking about virtual reality in almost all domains. So what's virtual reality? As you can see here, so one person can wear a very specific hardware designed for virtual reality, okay? And then there are specifically designed applications or videos. So the advantage of virtual reality is that you are really totally immersed into this. So when you look, when you move your head, so you are as if you're in the environment that the video or the application tries to showcase. Virtual reality, of course, requires some virtual reality hardware and also some virtual reality software. This hardware is increasingly available and affordable. It used to be more expensive. Now it's getting, with the advances in technology, it's getting more sophisticated, but at the same time, more affordable. So what are the pros and cons of this method?
So I guess most of the people have already heard about virtual reality and maybe also experienced it in the WPA previous meetings. So the pros is that it's mimicking symptoms and case scenario, which is make the experience really true. But it is very immersive and many senses are involved. So you can see, you can hear. The only problem is that it might not be convenient for some people because it first requires specific hardware and software, which not all the people will have, but also because some people might experience nausea and vertigo.
Even though nausea and vertigo are less common with better hardware, so when the images are fast enough, when the frame rate is fast enough, there is a lower likelihood of experiencing these side effects as well. So what are the pros and cons of using these methods? Why shall we change or maybe adjust our teaching methods? First, because most studies showed that these methods were associated with a very positive feedback from learners. We had also studies showing higher attendance rates when people converted to using these methods, enhanced learning outcomes as well. And then often they are perceived as fun, exciting. That explains the higher attendance rates, maybe. It can also help teamwork, so, and help teach participants teamwork. They can be applied to in person, but also online. Increasingly now with the pandemic, we need to find solutions that can be run online as well. And then it's very easy to obtain statistics. In most of these solutions, you can at the end download an Excel file containing all of the results or all of the answers. And you can even so keep a copy of that and use that for statistical purposes as well. So, however, there are, of course, some cons to talk about because some participants might get distracted. Some might not be comfortable with IT, especially the older participants. And then these methods may require some training from the teacher, even though, solutions are being increasingly easy to use and quite intuitive. So thank you for your attention. So this is one of the presentations in this symposium. In the next presentation, we are going to focus on the most maybe funny or exciting tool among the tools that we addressed in this presentation, that's to say live quizzes. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for your attention. And we hope that this presentation will give you some ideas for using new tools and innovative methods in your teaching methods.